Yeah.
Okay, so good morning, everybody. I hope everyone is doing well. So let me start this class by reminding you where we are. As you know, we are in the midst of considerations that will allow us to derive the second quantized forms of the one and two body operators. And then we'll move on to the generic case of a many body operator. And as you know, and as I emphasized this on Monday, the way we do it here is rather elementary. We proceed with a sequence of four lemmas, which we call lemma 1, lemma 2, lemma 3, and lemma 4. The first two lemmas, as you remember, were very simple. They just told us, telling us that we can identify slate determinants with the products of creation operators acting on the Fermi vacuum. Now, lemma 3 and lemma 4 are telling us how the annihilation operators act on the products of creation operators acting on the vacuum that represent basis states in the Fock space. So let me remind you lemmas 3 and 4. They will be very useful today. So lemma 3, okay, says the following. When we apply the annihilation operator XQ to the product of creation operators acting on the vacuum, I'm using this compact notation from the previous lecture, then we obtain a summation over I going from 1 to n, where I's are labeling the X dagger operators here. We have a phase factor minus 1 to the I minus 1, delta Q PI, and then we have a product of creation operators with the operator labeled with PI removed. Okay, that was lemma 3. At the very end of the lecture on Monday, I stated also lemma 4. So let me do it as well. So in this case, when we apply the product of annihilation operators to product of creation operators acting on the Fermi vacuum, representing one of the basis states in the Fock space, we end up with a summation which we actually have to split. It's going to be a double summation over I's and J's. The first part of this double summation sums over I less than J, running from 1 to n. Then we have the phase factor minus 1 to the I plus J, delta RPI delta SPJ, and then we have a product of the original X dagger operators acting on the vacuum with operators labeled by PI and PJ removed from that product. And then there is a second part to this formula, which I will continue writing here, where now we are summing over I greater than J, also going from 1 to n, where everything is pretty much the same except for the phase factor. So the phase factor is I plus J minus 1, minus 1 to the I plus J minus 1. Then we have the product of Kronecker deltas, RPI and SPJ, and then we have a product of all our X dagger operators acting on the vacuum, again with the pair of operators labeled by PI and PJ removed. That's where we are. We already proved lemma 3. We haven't proved lemma 4 yet, so that's what we should do now. Once we are done, we'll have the complete set of formulas that we need to move to the main topic, meaning the derivation of the second quantized forms of the one and two body operators. Okay, so let me start with the proof of lemma 4. I will try to keep these lemmas up there. Hopefully I'll have enough space on the remaining backwards. So Nicole, sometimes if you could point to the sky over there, that's where our lemmas are, you know, because that is handy for those who are watching the videos later. Although everyone is taking notes here as well, so I guess we have it in multiple places. Okay, so let me go first with the proof of lemma 4. Okay, so let's write proof of lemma 4. As you can easily imagine, you know, proof of lemma 3 was kind of lengthy, I believe. We agree that it was. Proof of lemma 4 will not be that long, because all we need to do now is to apply lemma 3 twice. We have two manipulation operators, so we simply have to apply them in a sequence, and that will give us the final result. We just have to do it carefully. So, okay, so let me start. So we have XR, XS operators acting on the product of X daggers acting on the vacuum. Okay, I will first apply the XS operator. And that means that I'm going to use lemma 3. Maybe I'll make this equality this time here longer and put the note that we are using lemma 3 for this part. So we end up with XR. You just have to copy from the top equation. That's going to be a summation. I'll use symbol J here for the summation, not I. I'll use I a little bit later. We have minus 1 to the J minus 1. We have delta SP. J, and then we have a product of all X dagger operators acting on the vacuum with PJ removed. Okay, so this is our lemma 3 in action. The next step will be this. I'm going to take this annihilation operator, which is a linear operator, move it right in front of the product, and I will apply lemma 3 one more time. So, okay, so let's do this. So I will have a summation over J. Of course, I'm not writing now the range of the summation. We all know that J is summed over values from 1 to n. Okay, we have minus 1 to the J minus 1. We have delta SPJ. I'm just copying first. And then we have XR placed in front of the product of X daggers, where PJ is removed. Because PJ is removed, let me write it actually explicitly. So we are accounting for everything carefully. Okay, so we have XP1 dagger over there. We have XP, after some dots, J minus 1 dagger. Then PJ is removed, so I'm not going to write it. Then we have XPJ plus 1 dagger. And then I have XPN dagger, and all of this is acting on the vacuum. Okay, so now what I need to do is to execute lemma 3. That means sum over J, okay? Minus 1 to the J minus 1 delta SPJ. I'm not changing anything here, okay? But now I have to sort of see what happens when I apply XR to this product of X daggers. Well, let me start writing it. I will open the brace, so you can imagine that it will be more than just one simple term. And let's see what happens. Well, you know, lemma 3 tells us what we should do. We should have a phase factor, minus 1 to the I minus 1. I'm going to fill this up in a moment. Then we should have delta R PI, where PI means that's the operator you're trying to remove. Okay? And then, when you remove PI from the sequence, you already remove PJ. That means that you remove both of them, PI and PJ. And we have a notation for it. Okay? So I'm not going to be writing these long expressions any longer. I'll just write what it's going to be. The problem is, what is the phase factor? Well, the phase factor I already wrote, but the thing is, does it apply to the entire sequence? Well, not really. This phase factor applies only to the first bunch of J minus 1 operators. Okay? So my summation here goes from J, over I, goes from 1 to J minus 1. When you go to the second part, which I'm afraid I have to start writing here, okay, so let's say we're going to this blackboard. The beginning is the same, it's minus sum over J, minus 1 to the J minus 1, delta SPJ over there. I will actually close brace here, so let's just start. Okay. I'm writing this again, essentially. Okay. So what do we have there? Well, we're going to have a summation over the remaining values of I, which go from J plus 1 to N. I equal J, of course, is not possible because we already removed the J. Okay. And of course, we'll have delta R P I, and the product of all the X dagger operators with PI and PJ removed, okay? But the phase factor will no longer be minus 1 to the I minus 1. Because we already removed one operator here, So what used to be located at the ith position is now in the I minus 1, in a position labeled as I minus 1. So I have to correct for this, and our phase factor will be then minus 1 to the I minus 2. Okay? You know, and that is for this bunch of creation operators. Okay? So that's the only thing that we have to watch out in this consideration. Just make sure that the phase factors are picked up in a correct manner. So if I, you know, now wrap it up, you can see that our lemma 4 is emerging immediately. We end up in the first case, you can see in each case we have a summation over I and j, but in the first case it's summation over I less than j. Okay, and then we have the overall phase factor will be minus 1 to the I minus 1 and j minus 1. So it's certainly minus 1 to the I plus j. I don't have to copy the minus 1s because they will, of course, cancel out and produce the plus. Then we have the product of canonical deltas, RPI and SPJ. Okay, you can see it here, RPI, SPJ. And then we have the product of all creation operators with PI and PJ once removed. So that's the first part. When I look at the second part, it's also a double summation over I and j, but now I is greater than j in it. The overall phase factor is minus 1 to the I plus j. Well, that is for sure. And then I could write as minus 3, but of course minus 1 to the minus 3 is the same as minus 1 to the minus 1. So I'm going to write it in this way. Then we have a product of deltas, RPI and SPJ, and again, RPI here, SPJ there, and the product of PI and PJ operators removed. Okay? Which, if you now look closely and compare to what's on the top blackboard over there, that's exactly lemma 4 that we're trying to prove. Okay? Alright, is this all clear? You know, you can see it's not a difficult calculus. It's sort of a little bit lengthy because we're still in the realm of using concepts that originate from sort of the description using stated determinants. That's why, you know, you will say to the stated determinants today pretty much goodbye, and you will see then that the whole thing will look much nicer when we start doing this. But we're still in the sort of transition period of our considerations. Okay, anyway, we have lemmas 3 and 4. I guess we're ready to go to the main topic. That is a topic of how the one and two mode operators look like. You know what I'll do now, if you don't mind? I'll cover this blackboard for a second. I'll write our big equations, important equations here. So I will use this blackboard as our storage facility for the formulas. Okay, and then I'll start going to the proofs. So we're going to prove now the following. If you have a one-body operator, which I write as capital O1, which in the first quantized form is written as a sum over little O1s acting on individual fermions, and let's assume that we have n of them, that would be the normal coordinate representation of it. Then in the second quantized form, this will become O1 equal to sum over spin orbitals P and Q, matrix element P little O1Q, and then XP dagger XQ. That is the product of the creation and elimination operators. Okay? Now, the I will define the matrix element in a second. For the two-body operator, we'll see that, you know, which is actually original, a sum over I less than j little o2 xi xj, that is, we are summing two-body operators that act in each case on the pair of fermions. We're summing over all possible pairs. Of course, to avoid double counting, we have to order them. That would be the expression you would use if you try to retain the standard first quantized formula. In the second quantization, this will emerge as 1 half sum over 4 spin orbital indices P, Q, R, S. The matrix element here will be PQ little O2 RS, and then we'll have xp dagger, xq dagger, xs, xr. In that order, okay? Matrix elements that show up in these expressions, I will probably define them on top of this blackboard, and I'll try, well, you know, they are not difficult, so if I erase them, I guess it's not gonna be a big drama, but I'll try to keep them like that on this space I have, okay? So for the matrix elements that you see in these expressions are as follows. If I want to know what is the matrix element P little O1Q, of course, using Dirac notation and definition of the scalar products, this is nothing else than you take this spin orbital psi p, which acts on coordinates of one fermion. I can call it simply little x. I don't have to put a number here because I'm going to integrate this over anyway. Okay, then we have little O1, it's not V, it's O, okay, which acts on coordinates of a single fermion psi q x, and you integrate over the say x, y, z and coordinates and the speed if it's an electron, okay? For other fermions, you have to choose another system of coordinates, but that's what you have to do. For the other matrix element PQO2RS, which is a two-body matrix element, chemists would call it a two electron integral, actually. That would be an integral which has, you know, now we're involved in pairs, which means that we're going to have a summation over two fermions. I'm going to call them x1 and x2. Our operator little o2 acts on the pair of fermions 1 and 2, and then we have psi r x1 and psi s x2, and we integrate over coordinates of both fermions. See, I'm calling them 1 and 2. I don't have to call them I and j or things of that sort because they're all indistinguishable. So I am integrating this over. So I can use the first and two in the integration. So this is the complete set of definitions. I will, of course, at some, you know, when we finish the derivations, I will start commenting on what these definitions really mean to us, okay? But let's first go with the proofs. You can see certainly that this is an entirely different language now. We no longer have the dependence on the number of fermions in the definitions of O1 and O2. Okay, so that's a big step. And of course, we should not be surprised. We are in the Fock space. So the particle number is not the key number. That's the number that you use at the, you know, when you start computing something. Of course, you need to know how many particles you've got in your system. Someone has to tell you this. Well, unless you use DFT, then you can take your density and you can integrate it over, and then it will tell you how many particles you have. So that's actually one nice thing about DFT. You don't have to remember that number because it comes up. But anyway, the important thing is that we are switching to a new language which is no longer using the n, the number of particles, as the key variable. It uses spin orbitals, same particle state in the definitions. Okay, so let's start with the proof of for the one-body operator. Okay? As I already, I think, mentioned on Monday, it's going to be the elementary proof. I will simply apply the one-body operator to a Slater determinant, because let's assume that that's all we know right now. I'll manipulate. I'll end up with some sort of a CI expansion in terms of determinants. And then I will replace determinants by the products of X daggers acting on the vacuum, which represent our basis states. And see what comes up. And you'll see that the formula you see here for O1 will emerge in a very natural way. So let me begin then. So I'm going to start with O1 acting on a Slater determinant, which uses spin orbitals P1 through Pn. And I will, at this point, be still explicit. We know that this determinant depends on n fermion coordinates. Okay? So, the first thing I need to do is to spell out what the determinant is and spell out what O1 is. Let me start with the determinant. So what we have here is O1. If you recall, the way I defined determinants was in terms of this idempotent antisymmetrizer. Okay, so I'm going to use this definition because it is particularly useful. Okay, so we have a square root of n factorial, if you recall from our previous lectures, that is an idempotent antisymmetrizer. And then we have a product of single particle states, which I will write in a compact form, so we don't have to write these lengthy expressions all the time. There will be, you know, lengthy expressions anyway, so I'm trying to save some space. It's a product of psi pk spin orbitals, psi pk acts on coordinate of the k fermion. You are multiplying over all fermions that you have here from k equal 1 to n, okay? And then you are anti-symmetrizing this expression with respect to the fermionic coordinates in it. So that's what it is. Okay, the first step I will take is this. Obviously, this is a constant. Operators that we're using are all linear, so I can write it in front. I'll do one more step. That is, the anti-symmetrizer commutes with O1. Maybe I'll emphasize this here. Why? Remember last time when I tried to define the one-body operators, I tried to emphasize that our many-body operators commute with permutations of fermionic coordinates. They are invariant with respect to these permutations, because if they weren't, you know, your operators will be changing the statistics. You can't do it. So they are symmetric. So if the operator commutes with permutations, then of course it commutes with the anti-symmetrizer, because you remember, anti-symmetrizer is nothing else than a linear combination of permutations. Okay? So O commutes with each one of them, so it commutes with the whole anti-symmetrizer. So that means that what I can do in my next step, which I'll try to perhaps, let's see, I think I can erase this now. So let's actually try to do some work with these blackboards. So in my next step, I will start moving terms around. That is, I will write it as square root of n factorial, anti-symmetrizer, so I'm writing those two in front. And then I have a product, and then I have O1, but I'm not going to start writing things explicitly. O1 is a summation over I from 1 to n, little O1 xi, acting on the product of spin orbitals psi pk xk over k running from 1 to n. Okay? So that's what we are dealing with here. If you want to use the sort of the, well, I don't want to call it ugly, but it is kind of ugly notation, you know, using first quantization. Okay? So we have square root of n factorial anti-symmetrizer, that comes from the definition of the square determinant. This comes from O1, and that's the product that we had in the determinant. Okay? Now, in the next equation, I have to realize the following. If you look at the summation, each of these O1s, or I should say for a given value of I in this summation, this little O1 operator acts only on one specific fermion, fermion number I. So I'm going to pull now the spin orbital here that uses the same variable, xi, okay? And I will manipulate on this form. So we end up with square root of the n factorial, an anti-symmetrizer, sum over I from 1 to n, little O1 xi. I am pulling a spin orbital psi pi xi from our product, because that's the one on which little O1 acts, and I'll keep the remaining ones inside the product. Of course, I have to say that that product does not include I anymore. Okay? So I'll write it this way. That means that in those cases do not include I. I is here. Okay. Now, one of the key steps. The key step is that you have to realize that our spin orbitals form a complete and orthonormal basis in a single particle space. Meaning that if I apply little O1, okay, to psi pi xi, you can write it as a summation over single particle states, say call them P, there will be a matrix element P, O1, pi, psi, p, xi. Okay? You know, if you want to write it in, say, Dirac notation, this equation would be equivalent to the very familiar little O1 acting on Pi, that would be a ket for a single particle state, gives you a sum over P of P O1 Pi and the ket P. That would be a Dirac notation. Nothing else than the straightforward application of the resolution of identity in the single particle space. Okay? But I will, you know, try to use this one, because that's the one we're using here. Okay? Alright. So with this, I now will take this formula and insert it there. So for a little while, things will get a little bit more complicated. Okay? Alright, so in my next step, if I continue our considerations, we have square root of the n factorial, an anti-symmetrizer, a sum over I from 1 to n, that we had. We have now one additional summation that this resolution of identity trick produces. So we have a summation also over P, all spin orbitals in the basis. And then we have a matrix element, little p, little O1, little pi. Okay? We have psi p acting on fermion I. And then we have a product of the remaining single spin orbitals in our original slate determinant. So, you know, this product where you have psi pk, xk, and you're multiplying over k different than I, running from 1 to n. Okay? Well, my next step will be to bring it back to a more organized form in terms of determinants. So what I'll do, now that I process the expression, I will take this part and move it right in front of the product of spin orbitals, because I want to see what determinants we're going to get there. Okay? Now I will try to find out what are they. So maybe, to remind you what we're doing, we have a one-body operator acting on a selected determinant phi p1 pn x1 xn, and we are at the stage where we have a summation over I, summation over p, okay? We have a matrix element p o1 pi, and then, well, let me actually write this determinant explicitly. So, you know, I will have square root of the n factorial and anti-symmetrizer as I wanted inside, and then this product, let me actually write it explicitly so we really see what it is. So what we have there is psi p1 acting on x1 dot dot dot, then we have psi p I minus 1 x I minus 1, okay, so up to the I minus 1 we're fine, but then you can see we don't have psi p I here. We're going to have psi p instead in that location. So I'm going to put now psi p x I right here. Maybe I'll put an arrow here, making sure that we see this. Okay, and then of course for the remaining states, maybe I'll open some bracket. I guess I have to continue, perhaps here. We will have psi p I plus 1 x I plus 1, and then all the way to psi p n x n. Close the bracket. Okay? So if you really now read this carefully, you see that this is a determinant where instead of pi, we have p. Okay? So let me actually write this in this form. That is, we just demonstrated with techniques of first quantization, standard sort of, using fairly standard steps, that if you apply the one-body operator to determinant, spanned by spin orbitals p1 through pn, okay, we end up with a double summation over I p. Try to still have it here. We have a matrix element p, O1 pi, and this whole long thing is a determinant that looks as follows. We have phi p1 through pi minus 1. See, I'm just reading from here. Then instead of pi, I have p. So I'm going to put it right here, maybe another arrow here as a reminder what happened. Then we have pi plus 1. And then we go all the way to Pn. So dot, 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 Pn. Of course, acting on the n fermions. Okay. Move this up a little bit. Okay. That's what we've got. And that is pretty much as you can get. if you stick with determinants. There isn't really, you know, there isn't much more I can do about this. But you can see there's something interesting. What happens when you apply the one-body operator to the state determinant, okay? You can see what the one-body operator does. It is simply replacing one of the spin orbitals by something else, typically. Later we'll call those single excitations or single substitutions in determinants. That's what one-body operator can do. It cannot promote two spin orbitals because it doesn't have that much of a power. That's what two-body operator will do. But it produces these single substitutions. Okay. But if, you know, that's all I can do right now with techniques of first quantization. So I will now, I guess I have to ask you, can I erase these definitions of matrix elements? Okay, we will remember what they are, so I will erase them. And I'll try to now perform a translation for, you know. I will go now from our first quantized form to the second quantized form using lemmas 1 and 2. These lemmas are telling us that I can replace determinants by the products of X daggers acting on the vacuum. Okay, so I'll do this. Okay, we have O1 acting on the product. Well, let me actually still write it explicitly. The next one will be compact. That's the left-hand side. What do we have on the right-hand side? It's a sum over IP. It's a matrix element, little p, O1, pi. And then you have a product of single particle state. Let me write it here. I have to fight for space. We have x dagger p1 up to, then we have xpi minus 1 dagger. Then instead of xpi dagger, we have xp. Okay. Then we have xpi plus 1 dagger. And then we have, after some dots, xpn dagger acting on the vacuum. That is what our translation does to us. You can see. Right now we have a string of creation operators, and the one we are particularly interested is right in the middle of that pack, instead of pi. My next step then will be, I'm going to try to move xp dagger in front. So I'm going to try to do this. I can do this because we know that creation operators anti-commute. Every time you flip them, you change the sign. So I will have to perform I minus 1 hops from where I am to go here, which will produce the the phase factor of minus 1 to the I minus 1. So let me do just this. Okay, so it's going to be a summation over I and P. We have P, O1, PI. Okay, we'll have minus 1 to the I minus 1. We'll have XP dagger. And now if I move this out, what is left we call a product of x daggers with pi removed. Okay, so I don't have to write any more of these lengthy things. I'm going to simply write that this is a product of the original x daggers with pi taken out. And we know, we put a little pi here to emphasize this. Okay, well, see, it begins to look sort of nice, but we're not there yet, although we're now almost there. Okay, so let me finish this off here. Okay, I'll take that other paper down here too, so we don't get confused. Okay. What I'm going to do now is the following. I will replace pi by q, and I will sum over q. Of course, I cannot do it just like that. I will have to introduce Kronecker deltas. Okay, to make sure that q's I'm throwing in are always equal to one of the pi's. Okay, so I will, for a moment, make it a little bit more complicated. Okay, so if I have O1 acting on the product of the x daggers, that's the left-hand side, I have a summation over I have a summation over p, I'm going to have an additional summation, so now I'm making this complicated, sort of triple summation, also over q, then we'll have p, little O1 q, because I'm replacing pi by q, okay? I will have a phase factor minus 1 to the I minus 1, but I, you know, I said that those q's can only, their values can only be pi's, Okay, so I have to stick another delta, qpi, to make sure that q equals pi. Okay, and then we have a product of all x daggers with pi removed. Well, this is now getting interesting, because you can see this expression has sort of two different components. It has a part that depend only on pq, that's this one, then one, okay? And I think I missed the xp dagger, so I have to write it somewhere here, okay? Okay, we have it, all right? So we have these three pieces, I mean, I should say two pieces, that is P01Q, this matrix element, and xp dagger, that do not involve I, and then the rest of the terms have I in them. So I'm going to simply write it accordingly. I will simply write first the summation over pq, because we know that the order of summations, you know, doesn't matter. You know, it reads, so we always obtain the same results. So I'm going to first write the summation over p and q. I'll write what does not depend on I, so that's the matrix element and xp dagger. And for the rest, I'll open the brace and I'll write the rest inside. Okay, clearly. So what I have there is a summation over I. That's what we still have to write. We have minus 1 to the I minus 1, that's here. We have delta QPI, that's here. And we have a product of all X daggers with PI removed. Okay? That's how we can rearrange this expression. Well, now, if you look up, that is lemma 1, lemma 3. Lemma 3 says that what you see inside the curly brackets is exactly the result of an action of x cubed on the product, on the original product of x daggers acting on the true vacuum. That's what it is. You can see this by direct inspection. Okay? Which means that I can replace our last equation by pretty much the final expression in our derivation, namely O1 acting on the product of X daggers acting on the vacuum gives us a summation over single particle states P and Q. We have the matrix element little p O1Q, okay, and then we have XP dagger there, XQ from lemma 3, all acting on the product of X daggers acting on the vacuum. Okay? Well, you can see what we produce now is something very interesting. We have O1 acting on the basis state in the Fock space, producing us something, that something will be here, acting on exactly the same basis state. Since this is true for every state in the Fock space, I didn't really say which one I'm picking up. Well, that means that I have an operator expression here emerging out of it. I can say that O1 is what's in the square bracket. It's a summation over PQ, P little O1Q, XP dagger XQ, which completes the derivation of the second quantized form of the one body operator. So I guess maybe that's a good time to take a little breath, and then we'll move on to the derivation of the two body operator. Okay? So let's have a few minutes, relax. You can ask questions if you like about this lecture or the previous lectures, and then we'll move on. Us that we should switch from this language as soon as we can. So I guess the next lecture will be the derivation, but then we'll move to second order condensation. We'll stick with it.
Are you already trying to solve the homework problems? Is everything clear so far in the homeworks?
Part of it is, but I expect that we will need some more to be able to do.
Yes. We still have time, right? So we'll still be there. There's a problem with contraction, I guess, right? So contraction will be introduced on Friday. So we'll be there soon. Well, that's one thing about the deadlines. You have to make sure that you cover the entire material before the deadline. But I think we're doing okay. And always remember, if there's anything about the homeworks or this stuff, you can always talk during the little breaks, or you can simply visit me in my office. Okay. Don't worry about that office hour. Of course, you may not see me if you don't warn me if I'm, you know, I may be around talking to someone.
So you had
yes.
You when you inserted the complete set to make L1 times psi equal to the sum, you moved L1 past the bra of X. Why can you do that? Because before it's outside of that.
Yeah, you can do it on either side. You know, because of course, you know, this is nothing else than the resolution of identity. Yeah,
right. That is confusing.
Right. Well, you know, if you write it like, sure, I mean, if I start with direct notation, right, all the way, what was it? We have O1, right, acting on PI, right? That's what we, I guess, had. So then, of course, you know, if you use the resolution of identity, you would write it actually like, you can do this, that's the unit operator, right, and then you have O1 PI. And I guess, is that what you're saying?
Well, yeah,
but then, this is a number, right? This is the function. So I can, of course, write it as a sum over P O1 PI, and write this cap here, the new one that emerges, right? Mm-hmm. And then, you know, so to be consistent with the rest of the expressions, I use psi P for this.
Right, but psi P is x with inner product with p, right? Is that what you're...
Psi p of x
is...
Well, yeah, if you write it, okay, if I want to write
it... So then you put the inner product on the left there.
No. Let me write one more thing and maybe you'll tell me if I'm okay. Answering the question or not. If I have x, say I here, okay, which means that I want to know what is the value of this expression at x I, mm-hmm. You know, I can propagate here. It's going to be here. And it's going to be eventually here.
Yeah.
Okay. So this is now psi p at xi, mm-hmm. And this is really O1 acting on psi pi.
See, that's what I don't like right there.
It looks like
you're moving O1 out of.
Oh no. You know O1. If you want to look at the definition, O1 is actually defined as O1, and there's a Dirac delta x minus x prime. If you go back to basic quantum mechanics. Right? So that O1 acts on XR as well. O1, if you go back to the first one, you know, the coordinate representation, O1 is O1 acting on the same coordinate. It's a value of O1 at the same XI as in the function.
Okay?
And I can, of course, if you want to make an argument a little bit more, to go back to sort of coordinate representation done in an elegant way with Dirac delta, you know, Dirac deltas can be proven to be eigenstates, formally speaking, of coordinate operators. So we can do this, right? We can always talk some more. But I think I read this. I just use these size here because I use size for the rest of them. Because we still use the coordinate representation. But of course, you know, we'll not do this too many times anymore once we're done. Okay, so I guess, can we restart? Everybody okay? Can we start?
I'll just say this is here.
Let me then clean the blackboards. I will still keep the top blackboard there, so that because it contains very useful information about lemmas that we are using, but at some point, of course, we will stop using them. Then I will make sure let's prepare this blackboard and let's move to the two-body case. It's going to be a little bit lengthier, but I think it's still good to see. So for two reasons. You know, first, we have to derive it. Otherwise, I wouldn't feel that we really covered the material properly. Maybe that's also be a good reason for you to actually learn or get convinced that we don't want to do this too many times. Determinants are not very convenient. Okay, so the length of the derivation will convince us that we really want to switch them to a better representation. Okay. In any case, I'm going to follow pretty much a similar recipe. I will start by applying a two-body operator to a determinant. And I'll try to come up with some sort of a CI expansion for this. Okay. Well, the first thing I'm going to write is this. As you recall, actually I still have a definition here of O2. The definition of O2 involves a summation over all possible pairs of fermions. But I already mentioned last time, and I think I said this today again, these operators are symmetric with respect to permutations of fermions, which means that O2 written for xi, xj is the same as O2 written for xj, xi, which means that I can actually rewrite my O2 operator as 1/2 a summation over all pairs except for the one where I equals j, because we don't have some interaction there, of xi, xj. Okay, and I have to put them 1/2 because I have to avoid double counting. Okay, so instead of using I less than j, which is a little bit inconvenient, I'll try to use an almost unconstrained summations over ij. Well, there's just one constraint here that I cannot be j, right? And the price I will pay is small. I'll just have 1/2. Okay, and then we have a determinant. Let me remind you that the determinant is the square root of the factorial, the idempotent antisymmetrizer, and the product of states psi pk, xk, where k runs from 1 to n. Okay, that's the beginning. Just like in the previous case of the one-body operator, we're going to use the fact that capital A commutes with a two-body operator. Okay? For the same reasons the one-body operator commutes with an antisymmetrizer, which means that I can actually take the antisymmetrizer, I go put it in a circle, move it right here. Okay. This is a constant, so I can do, of course, the same with it. I don't have to keep it inside. I can sort of, let's join the crowd and let's move the two of them in front. So that's my very first step. Okay, this is a little frame, so it doesn't bother us. We'll have 1/2 square root of the n factorial and antisymmetrizer in front. Then we'll have a summation over I different than j, little O2 xi xj. And then we have a product of all spin orbitals in our psi pk, in our determinant, psi pk. K goes from 1 to n. Okay? All right. Put it up a little bit. It's okay with you. And that's where we are. Okay. Now, we have to again realize that for a given pair of ij, this operator here acts only on these two fermions, I and j. So I'm going to pull out those two spin orbitals here that are affected by O2. That's the ij pair. Okay, so my very next step will be, if I continue here, 1/2 square root of n factorial, an antisymmetrizer, summation over I different than j. We have little O2 xi xj. I am pulling spin orbital psi pi, which involves coordinates of fermion I, psi pj, which involves coordinates of fermion j. And then we're going to have a product of all the remaining spin orbitals, psi pk. Remaining here means that k in the product cannot be I and cannot be j. Okay? And once again, I'll use the resolution identity which we applied to a one-body case. What I have here is O2 acting on psi pi xi, psi pj xj,
these products form a complete set in a two fermion space, an orthonormal set. So I can write this as a summation over, I think I'm calling this PQ in my notes, let me make sure. Yes, it's going to be a matrix element PQ, little o2, PI, PJ, and then psi P, XI, psi Q, XJ. Okay? Now, the next step is to take this and write it into here. So, I'm sorry, it's going to be a little bit long, but that's what it is. So, in my very next step, if I continue here, that equality sign applies to the drop formula, we get 1 half square, of the n square root of the n factorial, an anti-symmetrizer. We have a summation over I different than j. Those are the Fermionic coordinates. Then we have a two more summations over P and Q, the single particle states, which our resolution of identity trick is introducing. And then we end up with a matrix element, PQ, little O2, PI, PJ. Okay? Then we're going to have psi P, XI, psi Q, XJ. Okay? Psi P, XI here, psi Q, XJ over here. And then we have the remaining, the product of the remaining single particle states, psi pk. Okay? Pk cannot be I or j. You can already, you can see that, again, as you see, I'm really following the previous steps. It's just that we have a little bit more to write because we are in a little bit more complicated situation. So now the next step will be to take these two, square root of the n factorial and an anti-symmetrizer, and move them in front of our spin orbitals, because if we do this, we will produce a stated fermion of some kind. Okay? So let's now try to do this. You can see that those determinants will be such that instead of psi pi, we'll have psi p. Instead of psi pj, we'll have psi q. But now, it all depends whether I precedes j or it is after j. Okay, so we have to write this very carefully. We'll have to split this into two subcases. Perhaps I'll do it here so that it stays on the same length. So my next formula will be this. 1 half, a summation over, let's start with the case where I is less than j, sum over pq. We have a matrix element, pq, o2, pi, pj. Okay? And then, let me spell out what we see in the product. We have square root of the n factorial and an anti-symmetrizer because we move them inside. Then we have, let's open the bracket, psi p1 x1, we go with dots up to psi pi minus 1 xi minus 1. That's what you encounter first because I is less than j. I'm not going to have psi pi here, I will have psi p because that's the function of xi now. Okay? Maybe again I'll put a marker here to make sure that we know where we are. After that, I'll have psi p I plus 1 in general, and then I will have some dots. Maybe I'll do it here. And then we will have psi pj minus 1, which acts on xj minus 1. Okay? Then, not pj, but q, because psi q acts on xj, so it's going to be psi q here, acting on xj, again, maybe a little marker, this arrow here, okay? And then we have psi pj plus 1, xj plus 1, and then all the way to psi pn xn. Well, that's how lengthy this is, if you want to really use the first quantization. But we're not done yet, because that's just part of the expression. There's a second part, which involves those pairs where I is greater than j. So I have to continue by saying plus 1 half sum over I greater than J sum over PQ. We have the matrix element PQ, O2, PI, PJ. We have the square root of the n factorial and anti-symmetrizer. And now, in this case, the first spin orbital in the product I will encounter will be the one labeled with PJ, replaced now by Q, okay? So if I start writing, it's gonna be psi P1, X1, dot psi PJ minus 1, XJ minus 1, okay? That's the first one on the list. Then the next one normally should be psi PJ, but psi PJ is replaced by psi Q, so it's gonna be psi Q, XJ, maybe another marker here. Let's do it thick. Okay. Then we will have psi PJ plus 1, XJ plus 1, some dots. Okay. Then, and then we'll have psi PI minus 1, XI minus 1. As I said, I is now greater than J, then instead of psi pi, we'll have psi p, which is a function of xi. Maybe another arrow to mark its presence. Move this up a little bit. I'll move this up in a second, a bit more. And then we have psi pi plus 1, xi plus 1, and of course the rest is just dots, and psi pn xn. That is really lengthy, okay? So what I'm gonna do now, let me actually move this one up. Okay, so we see the whole thing. That's where we are. Imagine if I had to do it for a 10 body operator. Okay? Alright, so now I guess I'll go back to this blackboard and I will try to summarize our calculations so far. So what we're doing is O1 are acting on the phi. Okay. I'm going to retain this, it's actually handy enough. You can copy. And then what we have, you just have to read what we see. Okay. You can see that over there. You have 1/2. So let me start writing. 1/2. We have a summation over I. Less than j, we have a summation over pq. We have a matrix element, pq, little o2, pi, pj. And then we have a slated determinant, where instead of pi, we have p, instead of pj, we have q. It's a double substitution. So let's write this determinant here. Okay, it's going to be phi. And you just have to carefully list your indices. P1 dot 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 P I minus 1. Instead of PI, we have P, maybe another marker here. Then we have PI plus 1 dot 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 PJ minus 1. Instead of PJ, we have a Q, our marker again. PJ plus 1, and then all the way to PN. Okay, that's the determinant. And actually, all of this are the indices you need to. Right, to spell it out. Okay? Of course, this is a function of all orbits. Then there's a second part to our expression, which is 1/2, sum over I greater than j, sum over p, p's and q's, a matrix element, pq, o2, little o2, pi, pj, and then we have the determinant, phi, try to write it here, hopefully. Maybe below, because it's a long one. I'll move this up a little bit. And then I'll move this up. Okay, so what we're going to have, if you just have to read from the top blackboard, the second paragraph. You can see that what we have there is a determinant. Actually, you know what? I'm changing my mind. Let's try to do it here so that I don't have, because I'm not sure how much you can see at the bottom. Okay, so what we have is this. We have P1, dot, 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 we have P, J minus 1, then instead of PJ we have P, we have Q, sorry, so that's my other marker, okay, then we have pj plus 1 dots, then we have pi minus 1. Okay, I'm just reading from there. You can see we're right now here. Then we have p. Then we have pi plus 1. And then after dots, we have pn. And of course, it's a function of x1 to xn. Okay, this is what it is. You can see O2 acting on the Slater determinant produces a linear combination, a CI expansion in terms of determinants, which are typically doubly substituted. PI, PJs are replaced by Ps and Qs. Okay, well, that's about as much as you can do with the first quantization. Now we're going to translate this to a second quantized form. Okay? Now I have to start erasing these. I guess I can erase this part already. This was some time ago. Is that okay if I do this for everybody? I will still maybe keep the top part. Okay. So now translation. We know that all we have to do now, we have to replace the determinants by the product of x daggers acting on the true vacuum. So that's what I'm going to do. So on the left hand side, I have xp1 dagger through xpn dagger acting on the vacuum. And let's see what we have on the right hand side. It's 1 half sum over I less than j, sum over p's and q's, matrix elements, pq, little o2, pi, pj, and then we have a product of creation operators corresponding to our determinant. So it's going to be, maybe I'll try to write it here, it's going to be xp1 dagger, just copy from there, you know, it's going to be xp1 dagger up to xpi minus 1, xpi minus 1 dagger, so xpi minus 1 dagger, then we have xp dagger, maybe I'll put it in a circle, that's the one we'll be paying close attention to, then we have xpi plus 1 dagger, we continue, we have xpj minus 1 dagger, then we have xq dagger, again I'll put it in a circle because we're going to be paying closer attention to it, we have xpj plus 1 dagger, and then we're going all the way to xpn dagger, all acting on the vacuum, on the true vacuum state, right? That's the first part. Now we have the second part, translated in a similar fashion, 1 half sum over I greater than j, sum over p's and q's, the matrix element, pq, little o2, pi, pj, and again, a product of creation operators, which I guess I'll start writing here. Well, maybe, maybe not, actually, so it looks nicer. So we have xp1 dagger, we go all the way to xpj minus 1 dagger, then we have xq dagger, again, I'll put it in a circle, because we'll be doing something to it. Then we have xpj plus 1 dagger, then we are continuing to xpi minus 1 dagger, then we have xp dagger, again in a circle, xpi plus 1 dagger, and almost there, xpn dagger, acting on the vacuum. Well, that's as much as I have to write about in this long way. Now I'll try to, you know, shrink it. This is like, you know, in a chemical reaction, you have to go over the barrier. Well, that's my barrier probably right now. I am at the most complicated part. Now we're going to be trying to shrink all of this. Okay? So let me move this up. I guess I will now erase this one. And my next step will be to place, to move operators xp dagger and xq dagger, move them in front of the creation operators, okay? If I want to move xp dagger in front, okay, that will introduce the phase factor minus 1 to the I minus 1, because I have to perform so many jumps. So let me mark this. I'm going to be putting this right here. After this, I'll also move the xq dagger operator in front, okay? Maybe I'll try to do it this way. But I will put it before, sorry, after xp dagger.
in that order. Okay? So let's do this, and then I guess we'll go back to what we have to do with the second part. So we don't do all at once. So we'll have 1/2 sum over I less than j, sum over p's and q's, a matrix element pq, little o2, pi, pj. I'm going to have xp dagger, maybe, sorry, I should write the face factor. So let's leave some space. I'm going to have xp dagger, xq dagger, okay? Maybe I'll go back a little bit. When I remove those two, the rest of these guys are simply the product of all x daggers with pi and pj removed. Oh, that's a relief, because I have a notation for it, the short one, okay? I'll use it. So after moving out xp dagger, xq dagger, what I'm left with is the product of all x daggers acting on the vacuum with pi and pj removed. Let's go back to the phase factor calculation. As I said, the moving of xp dagger will produce minus 1 to the I minus 1. When you start moving q, in principle, initially you will think that it's j minus 1, but it's not, because we already took xp dagger out. So you have to shift our phase factor by 1 minus. So it's going to be j minus 2. That's the phase factor for the first part. Okay? And we're going to simplify this in a moment. Let's keep it the way it is right now. Okay. Our next step then will be to process in the same fashion the second part of our expression. So it's 1/2 sum over I greater than j, sum over p's and q's. The matrix element is the same, pq, o2, pi, pj. And again, I will try to perform a very similar operation as I did before. We're going to move xq dagger in front. I hope you can see this arrow. And I'm going to move xp dagger also, but as the next thing, okay? And I'll just write what comes up. Okay, so let me move this back where we were. So we'll have, let's leave some space for the phase factor for a second, okay? I'm going to put what we do here. Xq dagger is going first, xp dagger is going next. Once we remove those two, we can now write the product of all x daggers. Okay, acting on the vacuum with pi and pj x daggers removed. So now the phase factor. The removal of xq dagger from this list gives you a phase factor of j minus 1. The removal of p, xp dagger, moving it out the way I did, requires I minus 2 steps. So it's going to be plus I minus 2. I minus 2 because p is removed before. Okay? That's what it is. So now you can see we're shrinking our expressions. We're gonna start making them even simpler, and you know, as we go. Okay, so I'm gonna go back here. I guess we don't need this one anymore. You know, the worst thing that can happen to you when you teach is you erase this formula and then you made a mistake here, and then you have to go back to it. And what do you do? When it's so long, you have to write it again. Okay. I hope we don't have to do this. Okay, anyway, so all we have is this. We have a two-body operator acting on the product. Okay? We have a compact notation from Norman March and co-workers from the book, which is on the reserve list. Okay? That's the left-hand side. On the right-hand side, we have 1/2 sum over I less than J, sum over P's and Q's. We have a matrix element, P, Q, little o2, pi, pj. Then we have a phase factor, which is minus 1 to the I plus j minus 1, because that 2 is a plus, right? So we're going to have minus 1 to the I plus j minus 1. Then we have xp dagger, xq dagger, acting on the product of all x daggers, acting on the vacuum with pi and pj removed. I hope you can see this. Maybe you know what I'll do. I can rewrite. If you don't have to learn anything, I'll just try to maybe be a little bit more efficient with space here. There it goes.
doesn't have to be that big, minus 1 to the I plus j. Minus 1, then we have xp dagger xq dagger, a product of all x daggers acting on the vacuum with pi pj removed. Okay, now things look better. Then for the second part, we have 1 half sum over I greater than j, sum over pq. Matrix element is going to be the same, pq, O2, pi, pj. Now let's do two things at the same time here. So the phase factor will be I plus j minus 1j. But you see, I don't want to keep these operators in this order. I want to keep them in the same order as here, so I can start wrapping this up. So you can replace this one by minus xp dagger xq dagger, right? Because they anti-commute. So that means that the phase factor will be actually minus 1 to the I plus j, rather than I plus j minus 1. Okay, and we'll have xp dagger, xq dagger, okay, if I do this, and then a product of all x daggers acting on the vacuum with pi and pj removed. Okay, we're getting there. You can see this is beginning to look familiar. My next step will be exactly what I did for a one-body case. You remember, I replaced pi, pj by some generic symbols. And well, over there was just pi, and I summed over and put some conical deltas. I'm going to do exactly the same here. Okay? So my next step will be replace pi by, say, r, do the same thing here. Replace pj by s, introduce an additional set of summations over r and s, indices of spin orbitals, and then put deltas, delta RPI, delta SPJ, to make sure that we're not producing things that we didn't have there. Okay? So that's going to be my next step. Probably, let me do it here. Is it okay if I erase the top blackboard now? Okay. So let me try to do this here. We're now almost there. Okay, so what we have is O2 acting on the product of x daggers acting on the vacuum gives us 1 half sum over I less than j, sum over pq, and I said I am adding two more summations over rs, will have a matrix element pq, little O2, rs, will have delta r, pi, delta s, pj, to make sure that r and s can only be pi and pj, as they were here, okay? We'll have a phase factor, minus 1, to the I plus j, minus 1, and then we have the rest, which is xp dagger, xq dagger, a product of all x daggers acting on the vacuum, with pi and pj removed. Okay, that's the first one. The second part will have plus 1 half, a sum over I greater than j, sum over pq, sum over rs, those are the two summations we're adding to it. We have a matrix element pq little o2 rs to make sure that we're not introducing terms we didn't have there. We're going to have deltas, rpi, and delta SPJ, the conical deltas. Our phase factor is minus 1 to the I plus J. Then we have XP dagger, XQ dagger, a product of all X daggers with the PI and PJ ones removed. Okay, that's what it is. Now, if you look closely at this expression, the two terms, the two parts of this expression are very similar. They have lots of commonalities. First of all, and I will try to maybe emphasize those. Maybe I'll put them in circles. Both terms include the summation, the quadruple summation over PQRS. Right? Both, of course, contain 1 half. So that is obvious. Both contain the same matrix element. PQRS here, PQRS here. And both contain the same pair of creation operators, right? Here and there. But that's a lot.
You know, when you see so much, you probably want to write it outside the brackets. That's what I'm gonna do next. Okay? Just gonna move this up and see what we get. And as we'll see now in a couple of minutes, we're gonna complete our proof. Okay, so what I get is this, L2 acting on product creation operators acting on the vacuum gives us 1/2 a sum over 4 indices, P, Q, R, S. There's a matrix element, P, Q, O, 2, R, S. There is an XP dagger, XQ dagger pair. And now I'll write the rest. The rest will actually contain I and J in some way, so I have to write the rest inside some, say, big brackets like this. Okay, so what do we get there? From the first part, we get a summation over I less than J. We get minus 1 to the I plus J minus 1. Okay, and we get a delta R PI, delta S PJ, and we get a product of all X daggers with PI and PJ removed. That's the first part. The second part, it has a summation over I greater than J. Okay, if you read it from here, the phase factor is minus 1 to the I plus J. Then we have delta R PI, delta S PJ. And then we get, once again, the product of all operators X dagger acting on the true vacuum. Okay. I guess again, let me erase this and write it nicely. I write it below then maybe. The product of all X daggers acting on the vacuum with PI and PJ removed. Okay, and I close the code. Right. Okay, now look at lemma 4. This is a good time to do this. Just look here, look there. And you see, we see actually lemma 4. Maybe you can tell me. What's the difference, though? What's the difference exactly then? Yes?
They're switched.
The minus. Yeah, that's right. They're switched, which means that we differ by a sum. Okay? So what you see here in the curly brackets using lemma 4, it's actually, it would be, normally it would be XR, XS acting on the product of X daggers acting on the vacuum. But here, in order to have this, you would have to have I plus J here, and I plus J minus 1 there. But you don't. You have to multiply the minus there. Okay? That's what it is. But I'm not going to keep minuses like this, because I also know that I can flip XR and XJ and XS. They anti-commute. And this will allow me to remove that sign. Okay, so I will write this not in the way I have it here. I have it here in this way because that's lemma 4. Maybe I'll emphasize this. But I will write it without a sign and flip the operators. Okay, so that means that we are now. Now I would like to erase this part. Can I do this? Okay. According to our considerations, when you apply O2, the two-body operator, to the product of X daggers acting on the vacuum, we end up with 1/2 sum over P, Q, R, S, it's a quadruple summation, matrix element P, Q, little O2, R, S. Then we have XP dagger, XQ dagger, XS, XR in that order acting on the product of all X daggers that we had acting on the vacuum. That is pretty much the end of the proof, because we have a situation where O2 acting on this state
gives you this acting on the same state. But that state is one of the basis states in the Fock space. This is true for every state, the basis state in the Fock space. So I've got now my operator identity. O2 is 1 half sum over PQ RS PQ little O2 RS XP dagger XQ dagger XS XR. Okay? Which completes the proof. So now, what we want to do, we want to try to generalize it to a many body case, say, K body operator in general, right? And then I'll start coming here. So I'll erase this one now. So in order to do this, I will not do any more derivations, you know, that the proof would be by a simple induction. You can, you know, let's recognize the patterns here. So you can see that. In each case, when you write, if I want to know what is the k-body operator, let me remind you, k-body operator in a sort of traditional representation would be an operator which involves a summations of little o-k's over ordered sets of fermionic coordinates, all running from 1 to n, okay? But I want to actually emphasize one thing about the last expression. See, that is the way you define it, because you don't want to have any redundancies. But I can actually also write it as 1 over k factorial. And instead of summing over ordered sets of fermions, I can write, you know, sum over all sets of k fermions, subsets of k fermions. So, of course, they have to be different.
Distinct sets.
Sorry?
Distinct sets.
Yes, distinct sets. Yes, yes, yes. Right. But now all of them, rather than just those are the distinct, right? And now I'm going to have all of them because we know that these expressions do not depend on the permutation of fermionic coordinates, okay? And why am I talking about this? Because, as you remember, when I was dealing with the two-body operator, one body was sort of so simple you couldn't really see a lot there, right? But when you do two-body, you remember, the first thing I did, I replaced the I, the summation of I less than j, by 1 over 2, which is one of the two factorial, right? Allowing I different than j. You can see that that means that if you really want to write the formula for the k-body operator, the factor here that you will have will simply reflect on the fact that you can permute your k fermions in k factorial ways. So if I start writing what I think the expression is, it is simply 1 over k factorial. What else do we have then? We have a summation here. You can see for a one-body operator, it's two indices. For a two-body operator, it's four indices. So I guess for k-body operator, it's going to be 2k indices, okay? So let me write it. Let's call them p1, this is factorial, through pk, and maybe below I write q1 through qk. Then we have a matrix element, okay? Which, as you can see, is going to be listing indices in the bra, the little ok, indices in the k. Okay? Do I need to define it, or does everybody know what it is? It's an integral over psi p1 through psi pk, with asterisks, then ok, and then psi q1 through psi qk, right? So it's a complicated integral involving k fermions. Okay? For a chemist, that would be a 4k integral to start with, and then maybe try to simplify that. Okay, so that's the matrix element. And then we have a bunch of creation annihilation operators, with creation operators preceding the annihilation operators. Later we'll see that actually I don't have to do that when we introduce the normal ordered form. But right now, that's what we see there. And as you can see, there's a rule. The indices in the bra match the creation operators and preserve the order of them. So it's going to be xp1 dagger through xpk dagger. Then indices of the annihilation operators match the indices of the cat, but in a reverse order. You have to go backwards. And remember where it came from. At some point, I had a sign to correct for. Okay? So I will write them as x. So you sort of start from backwards. From here, you go this way. Xqk go to xq. Okay? That's the
form of the k-body operator. Okay? So now we can write it for two-body, three-body, four-body, and so on. There is another form I'm thinking now, I probably should not start it, but I'll write it, which I'll discuss next time, because it's very important for the diagrammatic language. What you see here is the form, those forms that you see here are forms which use the non-symmetric matrix elements. These matrix elements do not have a lot of symmetries in them. That is, all you can do with these matrix elements, if you want to say compute them and store them in some efficient way on a disk so you don't store too much stuff, too many gigabytes or terabytes, I can flip PQ and RS at the same time. Okay? In the integral, I can do this. You know, that is, if I flip 1,2 and 1,2, say, in the integration at the same time, I can do this because O2 doesn't change. Right? So in general, the symmetry of this non-symmetric, as we call the matrix element, is such that I can, if I want to permute anything, I can only permute P's and Q's at the same time, in the same way. If I do anything else, I get some new number. Okay? But there is another formula that is sometimes more convenient, which looks like this. So let me spell it out. It has a different factor, which is k factorial square, and instead of having the plane matrix element of the k-body operator, we have the so-called anti-symmetrized matrix element. Okay, that is too big. Okay, it's a, right now, a subscript script A, to emphasize that those will be the anti-symmetrized matrix element. Okay? The rest is the same. You know, creation or annihilation operators. So what is this object here? Let me define it below. It is a linear combination of non-symmetric matrix elements corresponding to all permutations of either the Q's, if that's what you choose, or the P's, but not both. You have to simply, in your mind, select what am I going to permute, either the P's or the Q's. I'm going to choose the Q's, because that's what most people do. So what you have here is P1 through PK, OK, and I'm going to permute indices 1 through K into, say, use some permutation R. You know, I use the capital R always. So it's going to be QR1 through QRK. Okay? And then you sum over all permutations of K indices, my symbol S now with a K, that's permutation of K indices, and there is a phase factor minus 1, I mean phase factor representing the sign of the permutation. Okay? That's the definition. So in other words, if your computer program generates non-symmetric matrix elements, okay, it is very easy for you to compute or pre-compute these anti-symmetrized matrix elements. They have a lot more symmetries. Because of that anti-symmetrization, not only that I can permute P's and Q's at the same time, but I can also permute P's or Q's separate by appropriate sign changes. Okay, so as the final equation, if I want to do this for a two-body operator, which I still have here, okay, let me erase this, okay, how would it look like that? For one body, no difference. There isn't there anything to anti-symmetrize. For a two-body, you would see an expression that looks like it's 1 over 2 factorial squared, which is 4, and it's going to be a summation over PQRS, and it's going to be a matrix element PQ, little O2 RS with an A symbol, and then a creation and annihilation operators, okay? So my final formula then is, let me erase this one, what is the anti-symmetrized matrix element here? We're permuting two symbols, so it's just two elements here. It's PQ, little O2 RS, minus PQ, little O2 SR. You know, those of you who know the Hartree-Fock theory, for example, know that there are two terms in it, the Coulomb and exchange terms. So in that sense, the first one is Coulomb, the second one is exchange, okay, because you flip the two symbols. Why am I talking about it? Because when I introduce diagrams, there will be two kinds of them. There will be the Goldstone diagrams, you know, the famous name in metabolic theory, who actually proved the linked cluster theorem, think you should be for the prize for that. This is so important. Okay? The Goldstone diagram, the Goldstone representation uses non-symmetric ones. So actually, I should put it here. Goldstone here. Okay. There is another representation which we call the Hugenholz representation. Another extremely important name in many body theory. We'll talk about it. Which rely on the anti-symmetrized matrix. And, you know, for some applications, it's better to use Goldstone diagrams, especially when you want to do spin adaptation. For some of them, you want to use Hugenholz diagrams. They are fewer in number. That's their huge advantage. You shrink your calculation to fewer diagrams. So it depends what your purpose is. But that's what it is. I guess I have to stop now. So thank you very much. I'll see you on Friday. Now, and we'll start talking about contractions and weak spin.